Hello and welcome back to the Sunday slot for this second in a mini-series about sacrifice. As I said last week, today could get a bit messy, but I promise you we'll get to a happy ending. But let's pray for God's presence and blessing on the time that we're about to share together. God, our Father, we thank you for all that you have done for us in Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that you'd send your Holy Spirit now to show Jesus to us and to guide us as we read your word. Father, would we know your presence and your peace through that Holy Spirit that you've given us? In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me damned. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, 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 filth made clean in the crimson sea. I'm not ashamed of what once shackled me. How infinite that grace divine. I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, 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 oh. Precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. I was buried Christ my Lord, now I am raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love.
I wonder how many of you will own up to watching Frank Spencer, played by Michael Crawford.
I'm Frank. Frank Spencer.
In addition to being an all-round disaster area, Frank, it seems, was a devout Catholic. And in one scene, he goes to confession. "Well, Father," he says, and I won't attempt to recreate the voice, "you know all those sins that I told you about last week?" "Yes, my son," says the priest. "Well, I've done them all again this week." And of course, the studio audience pealed with laughter. But in a way, that little excerpt sums up for us two more of the problems that we've got to get our heads around whilst thinking about this theme of sacrifice. For a start, as we saw last week, sin is not something to be laughed about. It is in fact deadly serious, because it leads to our separation from God. And secondly, even though we might want to, we cannot stop ourselves from sinning. We might try hard, but we end up, if you're anything like me, being rather like the hapless Frank Spencer and going back to God and saying, "Lord, I've done it all again." Last week we saw that sin is all about choosing our own will over that of God. When we think that we know better than God, that leads us away from Him and to separation. Worse than that, sin incurs God's righteous anger, His wrath. Because however much God loves us sinners, He is holy, and because He is holy, He hates sin. Inevitably, that leads to separation. Remember that we were created for a relationship with God, but sin sees that relationship broken. And one answer, as we began to see last week, was the idea of sacrifice. To put that very simply, perhaps too simply, an animal dies in our place. As early as Genesis chapter 3, we see this taking shape. And it continues to develop right through the history of what we now call the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, the early part, there are at least two really important examples of how sacrifice works. The first is in Genesis chapter 22. And the second is in Exodus chapter 12. We don't have time to read the Genesis passage today, so you might like to stop the video now, find your Bible and read Genesis chapter 22. So what we see in that passage is Abraham being tested by God, who calls him to go and sacrifice Isaac, the son that he loves. God never had any intention that Isaac should be harmed, and the sacrifice is stopped before he is harmed. But after Isaac is released, Abraham sees a ram caught by its horns in a thicket. He takes the ram and he sacrifices that in the place of his son. In Exodus chapter 12, the theme of animal sacrifice comes to the fore, and in fact is etched into the historic memory of the people of God, the Jews. We're going to read now about the Passover in Exodus chapter 12.
The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. The animals you choose must be year-old males, without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night, they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt."
So at the Passover, it was graphically illustrated to the people of Israel that the lamb died in their place. The lamb's blood was placed on the doorposts and lintels of their houses so that they would be passed over. The death of the lamb brings them both forgiveness and is the prelude to giving them freedom as they leave to journey to the promised land. And we've seen before how the journey to the promised land is not as simple as we might have imagined. And actually it took 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. And it's really during that wilderness period that the idea of animal sacrifice develops into a whole system based around first the tabernacle and later, when it's built, the temple. Now, I wonder if you've ever tried to read the Bible from the beginning to the end. It's quite a challenge. You start off with Genesis. Well, there's some good stories in there. And Exodus is a good read as well. But then you hit the book of Leviticus. And it's often when people get to Leviticus that they begin to stall and many give up. Because Leviticus is all about the sacrificial system. It's all about what to sacrifice, when, and how.
Now remember, the story of the Bible began with humans in God's presence, but they were banished because of their rebellion. However, God wants to be in relationship with us, so he chooses one family that he will use to restore the world back into his presence.
And so God's presence comes to dwell in a tent right in the middle of Israel.
And that's great.
But it creates a problem because it's so intense that Moses can't go in, and other priests who enter inappropriately, they die.
Well, wait, if God's presence is good, how is it all of a sudden dangerous for people?
So think of it this way. God's presence is like the sun. It's pure power and goodness. And when something mortal and corruptible gets close to such pure power, it's destroyed. And so the word holiness is used in Leviticus to describe God's pure and powerful presence, which, like the sun, is both good and dangerous. So the point of Leviticus is to show how corrupt Israelites can live near God's goodness without being destroyed. Now, in the book, there are three ways for how this is all going to work out, and these are going to seem strange to you, but just hang in there with us.
The first one is rituals, the second is this idea of the priesthood, and the third is a bunch of purity laws.
Now, the book is broken up into seven sections, and each solution is explored in two sections of the book. The rituals are here, the priests are here, and the purity laws go here.
Now, the first solution, rituals, involves a lot of animal sacrifices. And so Leviticus begins with detailed instructions for how to make these sacrifices. Some are ways of saying thank you to God, and others are simply ways of saying I'm sorry.
But what comes across really clearly from the book of Leviticus is that sacrifice is about a number of things. It's about gratitude. In offering sacrifice, you give thanks for who God is and what he has done. It's about sorrow for our sins. Sacrifice underlines for us that sin is to be taken seriously, because God takes sin seriously. And thirdly, sacrifice is about attempting to restore that broken relationship between us and God. And all this comes together in the greatest sacrifice of all. In Leviticus chapter 16, we read about the Day of Atonement. Again, we don't have time to read that now. Maybe you'd like to stop the video and read Leviticus chapter 16. So, on one day of the year, one man, the high priest, would enter into God's presence on behalf of all the people of Israel. And he would take with him blood. He would take the blood of a bull for his own sins and one of two goats. He would smear the blood on the altar and so satisfy the wrath of God. And when the high priest emerged from the sacrifice, when he reappeared, The people would know that their sacrifice had been received and that their sins had been atoned for. And there's one more sacrifice attached to the Day of Atonement. What about the other goat? Well, he became the scapegoat. The priest would lay his hands on the goat's head, symbolically transferring the sins of the people onto the goat, which would then be led away into the wilderness and released to carry the people's sins far from them. I suppose it all seems a bit bizarre to us, but can you see how much of the language that we use to talk about the death of Jesus comes from this ceremony about the Day of Atonement? How we see that Jesus carries our sins away, and how his blood mends the broken relationship between us and God. One thing you can't miss if you read the book of Leviticus is that there is blood everywhere. Sacrifice was messy. It was bloody. And the smell must have been terrible. But when you went home at the end of the sacrifice, you would go home glad that the animal, the bull, the goat, the lamb, had died in your place, that he had died so that you didn't have to, that your sins had been taken away and your relationship with God was mended once more. As we did last week, let's now come out of the blood and gore of Leviticus and go instead to another of those classic New Testament passages about Jesus' sacrifice for us. We're going to read now from Romans chapter 3, verses 21 to 25a.
But now apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood, to be received by faith.
In that passage, there is bad news and there is good news. The bad news is that all of us fall short. The word that Paul uses there is a military word. It means that an arrow or a javelin falls short of its target. It fails to do what it needs to do. And we all fall short. There are no exceptions. Well, actually, there is one exception, and I'll talk much more about him next week. But our good intentions are never going to be good enough. We sing a song sometimes that begins, "Who, O Lord, can save themselves?" And the answer is that we can't. And even if we are determined that we will do better next time, many of us have a pattern of falling back into the same sin again and again. We're back with Frank Spencer saying to God, I've done it all again. Because a sacrifice cannot take away our propensity to sin. It cannot change us. Only God can do that. Again, more about that next week. The bad news is that we can't save ourselves. But the good news is, as Paul says, all are justified freely by God's grace through the redemption that came through Jesus Christ. Now, there's a couple of key words there that we need to take hold of. The word justified comes from the Roman law courts. And if you were justified, it meant that you were found to be righteous. Through Jesus' death and resurrection, you and I are counted righteous, even though we are not. And then there's that word redemption. That comes from the slave market. In those days, a slave could be released if somebody redeemed them, paid the ransom price for them. There's language that we use about the death of Jesus, because through his death, the price is paid for us, and we are set free to live for God. Next week, I'm going to talk more about the sacrifice of Jesus, what the old Anglican prayer book called the one perfect sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. We're going to see how through Jesus' blood we can be changed, and all that through his sacrifice. No wonder we sing songs about amazing grace and a wondrous story. What an incredible Saviour we have.
Who, O Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? Our shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deep still. Who, oh Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? Our shame was deep. Still, you alone can rescue you.
And Lord Jesus, we join in that chorus. To you alone belongs the highest praise. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you didn't leave us in the mess of our sin, but you came to find us. You came to reach us. You came to save us. And by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free to live for you. And we pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon your church and upon us as we go into this new week. We pray that this week we would be so aware of your presence with us, that we would be so reminded of your love for us, that we would be ready to share your love and your grace with all that we meet. Father, may we know your blessing this week. Jesus, may we know your love. Holy Spirit, would you inspire and empower us to live for you and to your glory? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So next week, we're going to look in a little more detail at the sacrifice of Jesus and what that means for you and for me. I hope you have a great week, and I look forward to being with you very soon. Until then, bye for now.